We already have an overview video of DNA, and I encourage you to watch that first. But what I want to do in this video is dig a little bit deeper, actually get into the molecular structure of DNA. And just as a starting point, let's just remind ourselves what DNA stands for. I'm going to write the different parts of the word in different colors. So it stands for deoxyribonucleic acid. So I'm just going to put this on the side. And now let's actually look at the molecular structure and how it relates to this actual name, deoxyribonucleic acid. So DNA is just a general term for a nucleic acid. And it's the term nucleic comes from the fact that it's found in the nucleus. It's found in the nucleus of eukaryotes. So that's where the nucleic comes from. And we'll talk about in a second why it's called an acid, but I'll wait on that. And now each DNA molecule is made up of a chain of what we call nucleotides. So what we call nucleotides. So it's made up of nucleotides. So what does a nucleotide look like? Well, what I have right over here is I have two strands. I've zoomed in two strands of DNA, So you could view this side right over here as the backbones of, or one side of the ladder. This is the other side of the ladder. And then each of these bridges, and I will talk about what molecules these are kind of the rungs of the ladder. And a nucleotide, let me separate off a nucleotide. So a nucleotide would, what I am cordoning off right over here could be considered a nucleotide. So that's one nucleotide, and then it's connected to another nucleotide right over here. And on the right-hand side, we have a nucleotide right over there. And then, we have a nucleotide right over here on the right side. And then right below that, we have another nucleotide. So depicted here, we essentially have four nucleotides. These two are on this left side of the ladder. These two are on the right side of the ladder. Now let's think about the different pieces of that nucleotide. So the one thing that might jump out at you is we have these phosphate groups. So this is a phosphate group right over here. This is a phosphate group right over here. Each of these nucleotides have a phosphate group. So this is a phosphate group over here, and this is a phosphate group over here. Now the phosphate groups are actually what make DNA, or actually what make nucleic acid an acid. And you might say, wait, the way you've drawn it, Sal, you have a negative charge. Something with a negative charge would attract protons. It would sop up protons. How can you call this an acid? This actually looks more basic. And the reason why DNA is typically drawn with these negative charges here is that it's so acidic, and if you put it into a neutral solution, it's actually going to lose its hydrogens. Actually, the DNA, if we actually want to be formal about it, the DNA molecules would actually have its phosphates protonated like this, but it so badly wants to lose these hydrogen protons, so it typically would be, let me draw it like this. Let me get rid of the negative charge just on this one, just on this phosphate group over here. So if you get rid of the negative charge, and if this was bounded, this is bonded to a hydrogen, this so badly wants to grab these electrons. So this oxygen can grab these electrons, and then this hydrogen will just be grabbed by another water molecule or something, so the proton will be let go. That's why we call it an acid. So if it wasn't in a solution, it would have the hydrogens, but it would be very acidic. As soon as you put it into a neutral solution, it's going to lose those hydrogens. So the phosphate groups are what make it an acid, but it's confusing sometimes, because usually when you see it depicted, you see it with these negative charges. And that's because it has already lost its hydrogen proton. You're actually depicting the conjugate base here, but that's where it gets its acidic name from, because it starts protonated, or it gets in its acid form, it's protonated, but it readily loses it. And so that's why that's where it gets the name acid form from. So each of these nucleotides, they have a phosphate group. Now the next thing you might notice is this group right over here. It is a cycle, it is a ring, and it looks an awful lot like a sugar, and that's because it is a sugar. So this sugar is based on, it's a 5-carbon sugar. What I have depicted here, this sugar, this is ribose. So this sugar right over here is ribose. This is when it's just as a straight chain, and like many sugars, it can take a cyclical form. Actually, it can take many different cyclical forms, but the one that's most typically described is when you have the, let me actually number the carbons, because carbon numbering is important when we talk about DNA. If we start at the carbonyl group right over here, we call that the 1-carbon, or the 1' carbon. 1', 2', 3', 4', and 5'. That's the 5' carbon. And so you form the cyclical form of ribose is if you have the oxygen, right over here on the 4' carbon, it uses one of its lone pairs to form a bond with the 1' carbon. And I drew it that way because it kind of does bend. The whole molecule is going to have to bend that way to form this structure. And then when it forms that bond, the carbon can let go of one of these double bonds, and then the oxygen can use those electrons to go grab a hydrogen proton from someplace. So to nab on to a hydrogen proton. So when it does that, you're in this form. And this form, just to be clear of what we're talking about, this is the 1' carbon, 1', 2', 3', 4', and 5' carbon. And where we see this bond, this is the 1' carbon. It was part of a carbonyl. Now it lets go of one of those double bonds so that this oxygen can form a bond with a hydrogen proton. So it let go of a double bond there so that this could form a bond with a hydrogen proton. So this hydrogen proton is that hydrogen proton right over there. And this green bond that gets formed between the 4' carbon and, or between the oxygen that's attached to the 4' carbon and the 1' carbon, that's this bond right over here. This oxygen is that oxygen right there. Notice, this oxygen is bound to the 4' carbon, and now it's also bound to the 1' carbon. And it was also attached to a hydrogen, so that hydrogen is there, but then that could get nabbed up by another passing water molecule to become hydronium, so it can get lost. And you know, net, it grabs up a hydrogen proton right over here, and so it can lose a hydrogen proton right there, so it's not adding or losing net. And so you form this cyclical form. And the cyclical form right over here is very close to what we see in a DNA molecule. It's actually exactly what we would see in an RNA molecule, in ribonucleic acid. And so what do we think we're talking about when we say deoxyribonucleic acid? Well, you could start with, you have a ribose here, but if we got rid of one of the oxygen groups, and in particular if we just got rid of one of the oxygens, we replace a hydroxyl with just a hydrogen, well, then you're gonna have deoxyribose. And you see that over here, this 5-member ring, you have 4 carbons right over here. It looks just like this. The hydrogens are implicit, and the carbons, we've seen this multiple times, the carbons are at where these lines intersect, or I guess at the edges, or maybe and also where these lines end right over there. But you see, this does not have an OH. This molecule, if we compare these two molecules over here, we see that this guy has an OH, and this guy implicitly just has, this guy has an OH and an H. This guy implicitly has just 2 hydrogens over here. So he's missing an oxygen. So this is deoxyribose. So deoxyribose doesn't have this oxygen. It does not have the oxygen on the 2' carbon. So this, if you get rid of that, this is deoxyribose. So let me circle that. So this thing right over here, that is deoxyribose. It's based on deoxyribose. I guess before it bonded to these other constituents, you could consider this deoxyribose. And so that's where the deoxyribo comes from. And then the last piece of it is this chunk right over here. And these we call nitrogenous bases. So nitrogenous bases. And you can see we have different types of nitrogenous bases. This is a nitrogenous base. This right over here is a different nitrogenous base. This right over here is another different nitrogenous base. Notice, this one only has one ring, this one has one ring, this one has two rings. This one over here has two rings. And we have different names for these nitrogenous bases. The ones with two rings, the general categorization, we call them purines. So nitrogenous bases, if you have two rings, we call them purines. That's a general classification term. Let me make sure, purines. And if you have one ring, and maybe I'll just write it this way, one ring, we call these pyrimidines. Pyrimidines. We call these pyrimidines. And these two on the right, these two purines, this one up here, this is adenine. And we talk about how they pair in the overview video on DNA. But this one right over here is adenine, this nitrogenous base. This one over here is guanine. That is guanine. And then over here, this single ring nitrogenous base, which makes it a pyrimidine, this is thymine. This right over here is thymine. This is thymine. And then last but not least, if we're talking about DNA, when we go into RNA, we're also going to talk about uracil. But when we talk about DNA, this one over here is cytosine. Cytosine. And you can see the way it's structured, that thymine is attracted to adenine, it bonds with adenine, and cytosine bonds with guanine. So how are they bonding? Well, the way that these nitrogenous bases form the rungs of the ladder, how they're drawn to each other, this is our good old friend hydrogen bonds. And this all comes out of the fact that nitrogen is quite electronegative, so when nitrogen is bound to a hydrogen, you're going to have a partially negative charge at the nitrogen. Let me do this in green. You're going to have a partial negative charge at the nitrogen and a partially positive charge at the hydrogen. And then oxygen, we've always talked about as being electronegative, so it has a partial negative charge. So the partial negative charge of this oxygen is going to be attracted to the partial positive charge of this hydrogen. And so you're going to have a hydrogen bond. And that same thing is going to happen between this hydrogen, which is going to, its electrons are being hogged by this nitrogen, and this nitrogen, which itself hogs electrons, so that forms a hydrogen bond. And then down here, you have a hydrogen that has a partially positive charge because its electrons are being hogged. And then you have this oxygen with a partially negative charge. They're going to be attracted to each other. That's a hydrogen bond. Same thing between this nitrogen and that hydrogen. And same thing between this oxygen and that hydrogen. And that's why cytosine and guanine pair up. And that's why thymine and adenine pair up. And we talk about that as well in the overview video of DNA.